طيب بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. إن شاء الله we continue with our book that's the شمائل or the characteristics or the beautiful characteristics of رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. And we said this covers almost every aspect of the life of رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. Today we are in chapter 36 and the chapter is titled باب, which is chapter ما جاء في صفة مزاح رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. Narrated.
What has been narrated concerning the description of the light-hearted nature of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
Starting with hadith number 235. حدثنا محمود بن غيلان حدثنا أبو أسامة عن شريك عن عاصم الأحول عن أنس بن مالك قال أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال له يا ذا الأذنين.
Anas ibn Malik related that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said to him, O two-eared one. Mahmud said, Abu Usama said, he was being light-hearted with him.
Now, actually this term is used like sometimes when you joke about somebody or something like that, or you want actually to what we call direct their attention. You take a description of him, and طبعاً they said actually Anas had good big ears, like some people have very big ears, you can see them. So the Prophet Asam used that something to attract his attention or to give him that what we call lightheartedness. Hadith number 236. حدثنا حناد ابن السري حدثنا وكيح عن شعبة عن أبي التياح عن أنس ابن مالك أجين رضي الله عنه قال إن كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ليخالطنا حتى يقول الأخ له لأخ أخ له صغير يا أبا عمير ما فعل النقير.
The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam would lightheartedly interact with us, even once saying to a younger brother of mine, O Abu Umair, what did the Nughayr do?
Nughayr, by the way, is a bird. Like he had a bird, he used to have a lot of light bird, and this kid was living with the bird. So the Prophet ﷺ again wants to attract his attention to show him this lightheartedness. So he says to him, Ya Aba Umayr, Ya Aba Umayr, this is his nickname. Ma fa'al al-Nuqayr, like what did the bird do? So what is your bird doing basically? Again, this is a continuation, I think, of this hadith because it has no number on it. He says, قال أبو عيسى وقفة لهذا الحديث أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان يمازح وفيه أنه كنا غلاما صغيرا فقال له يا أبا عمير وفيه أنه لا بأس أن يعطى الصبي الطير ليلعب به وإنما قال له النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يا عمير ما فعل النقير لأنه كان له نقير يلعب به فمات فحزن القلام عليه فما زحه رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فقال يا أبا عمير ما فعل النقير.
The understanding derived from this hadith is that the Prophet ﷺ would engage in light-hearted behavior with others. It also shows that he would give young children agnomens, kunyas, as he said to the boy, O Abu Umair. It also shows there is nothing wrong with giving a child a bird to play with. The reason why the Prophet ﷺ said to the boy, O Abu Umair, what did the Nughayr do? This is because he had a Nughayr that he played with, which had died. Its death saddened the boy, so the Prophet ﷺ behaved lightheartedly with him and said, O Abu Umair, what did the Nughayr do?
Now this hadith number 237. حدثنا عباس ابن محمد الدوري حدثنا عن أبي الحسن عن شقيق حدثنا عبد الله بن المبارك عن أسامة بن زيد عن سعيد المقتري عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال قالوا يا رسول الله إنك تداعبنا فقال نعم غير أني لا أقول إلا حقا.
They, the companions, said, "You are light-hearted with us, O Messenger of Allah." He replied, "Yes. However, I only speak the truth."
This is important, by the way. The Prophet ﷺ was to teach us from this that when you joke, even if you want to say something light, you have to be careful. You have to see which is truth. And sometimes people go, you know, in today's world, they have all these bad jokes and so on. Sometimes they are very offensive. Sometimes they are not out of place. So even as he said, لا أقول حقا, معناه the words he says, even when he is joking, they are truthful words. And this is what the Prophet ﷺ went to teach us, inshallah. Now, this hadith number 238. حدثنا قتيبة بن سعيد, حدثنا خالد بن عبد الله عن حميد عن أنس بن مالك أن رجلا استحمل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فقال إني حاملك على ولد ناقة. فقال يا رسول الله, أما ما أصنع بولد الناقة؟ فقال, وهل تلد الإبل إلا النوق؟
A man once asked the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam for a mount, and the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to him, "I will give you the child of a she-camel as a mount." The man said, "O Messenger of Allah, what am I going to do with the child of a she-camel?" The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Do not all she-camels give birth to camels?"
This hadith number 239. حدثنا إسحاق بن منصور, حدثنا عبد الرزاق, حدثنا معمر عن ثابت عن أنس بن مالك أن رجلا من أهل البادية كان اسمه زاهر, وكان يهدي إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم هدية من البادية, فجهزه النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا أراد أن يخرج. فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, إن زاهر باديتنا ونحن حاضروه. وكان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يحبه, وكان رجلا دميما. فأتاه النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يوما وهو يبيع متاعه, فاحتضنه من خلفه وهو لا يبصره, فقال, من هذا؟ أرسلني. فالتفت فعلم النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, فجعل لا يألو ما ألصق ظهره بصدر النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم حتى عرفه. فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, يقول, من يشتري هذا العبد؟ فقال, يا رسول الله, إذن والله تجدني كاسدا. فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, لكن عند الله لست بكاسد, أو قال, أنت عند الله غال.
There was a man from the Bedouins named Zahir who would gift the Prophet ﷺ things from the desert, and the Prophet ﷺ would give him supplies when he wanted to leave. The Prophet ﷺ said to him, "Zahir is our companion of the desert and we are his companion of the city." The Prophet ﷺ loved him dearly. Now Zahir was an unsightly man, and one day the Prophet ﷺ approached him as he was selling his wares in the marketplace. He went behind Zahir and embraced him. Zahir, unable to see who it was, cried out, "Who are you? Let me go." He looked back and saw it was the Prophet ﷺ and tried his best to rub his back on the Prophet ﷺ's chest. The Prophet ﷺ began to call out, "Who will purchase this slave?" Zahir said, "O Messenger of Allah, in that case, by Allah, you will find that I am valueless." The Prophet ﷺ said, "Nay, in the sight of Allah, you are not valueless." Or he said, "Nay, in the sight of Allah, you are expensive."
نعم, this is a beautiful story, right? نعم. طيب يعني معنى by the way, this shows that the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام was an ordinary person. I mean, when he has his companions, he will joke with them, he will hold them just like what we do and so on, especially what he did for this particular man because he was very close to him and to Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. Now, hadith number 240, حدثنا ابن حميد, حدثنا مصعب بن مقدام, حدثنا المبارك بن فضالة عن الحسن قال, أتت عجوز النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فقالت, يا رسول الله, ادعو الله أن يدخلني الجنة. فقال, يا أم فلان, إن الجنة لا يدخلها عجوز. قال, فولت تبكي. فقال, أخبروها أنها لا تدخلها وهي عجوز, إن الله تعالى يقول, إنا أنشأناهن إن شاء فجعلناهن أبكارا عربا أترابا.
An elderly woman came to the Prophet ﷺ and said, "O Messenger of Allah, pray to Allah that he admits me into paradise." The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam replied, "O mother of so and so, no elderly woman will enter paradise." He said, "The woman turned to leave and began to weep." The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Tell her that she will not enter paradise as an elderly woman, for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, 'We have created them in a new creation and made them virgins, as beloveds equal in age.'"
So this is what again the Prophet ﷺ told us, that there are three processes of transformation that happens to people, inshallah, when we go to Jannah. We pray Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala all take us to Jannah. طبعاً, number one, that all people are all aged, they'll be transformed into youth. Just like what the Prophet, actually Allah says, إِنَّا أَنْشَأْنَهُنَّ إِنْشَاءَ, it means we have recreated them, فَجَعَلْنَاهُنَّ أَبْكَارًا, like a bishop means a woman who's not married. And then عُرُبًا, like this is a description that Allah gave them for the youth. The second transformation that is going to happen to us is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give us the power to see Allah. Because in this dunya, we don't see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We couldn't. Even the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam didn't specifically say, when he went to his journey on Isra and Mi'raj and went to Sidrat al-Muntaha, when he came back, even the Sahaba debated about this. A lot of discussion about them, whether Allah actually saw Allah or not. Because in one hadith, Aisha radiallahu anha said, he was asked, "Did you see Allah?" And he said, "Nurun anna arah." Yani there's intense light, I cannot see through it, which means I didn't see Allah. In another one, طبعاً Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself said, "Don't ask me about whether I saw Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala." He said, "In this worldly life, nobody could see Allah." So based on this, they say Allah didn't see, the Prophet didn't see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And طبعاً in the other hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that when people will be asked in Jannah, "Do you want more in paradise?" Then هل من مزيد, they said this مزيد would be that Allah will reveal himself to them. And you know the story of Musa alayhi salam, when the Israelites actually came, they used to ask Musa to show them Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he went to Allah and he said to me, "Ya Allah, قال أرني كيف أنظر إليك," show me how I can see you. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him, "لن تراني," you will never be able to see me, because you are not equipped to see me. That's the transformation that's going to happen to paradise, where people will have an equipment where you can see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the verse is clear, وَجُهٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ نَاظِرَ إِلَىٰ رَبِّهَا نَاظِرَ, like it would see Allah directly. So, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave Musa alayhi salam, as you know, story, the test actually for him. He said to him, "لن تراني ولكن but انظر إلى الجبل." They said this جبل الطور. فإن استقر مكانه, if you can stand this mountain, stay in this place, then you'll be able to see me. Then Allah says, فلما تجلى ربه للجبل جعله دكا, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a moment wiped the mountain, completely vanished. طبعا when it vanished, the whole museum disappears. فخر موسى صائقا, like Musa alayhi salam was stunned and then he blacked out. When he came back, he says, subhanallah, you know what can do. So this is the second transformation that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has set for us. طبعا the third, the Prophet alayhi salatu wa salam spoke about the replacement, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in paradise there is a place for everyone. So, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will replace the places where the people who got fired by people who come to paradise. So he's going to replace these places for them in paradise. This is where people get actually multiple spaces in paradise. These are the three transformations that the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam spoke about. I think that finishes the section on مزاح of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. Now we are going to chapter 37. باب ما جاء في صفة كلام رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم في الشعر.
What has been narrated concerning the poetry cited by the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم.
This starts with hadith number 241. حدثنا عن ابن حجر, حجر actually, حدثنا شريك عن مغداد ابن شريح عن أبيه عن عائشة رضي الله عنها قالت, قيل لها: هل كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يتمثل بشيء من الشعر؟ قالت: كان يتمثل بشعر ابن أبي رواحة، ويتمثل بقوله: ويأتيك بالأخبار ما لم تزوده.
On the authority of Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, who was asked, did the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam ever recite poetry? She replied, he would recite the poetry of Ibn Ruwayha, and cited his stanza, and he whom you've not provisioned shall come to you bearing news.
Naam, this is a poetic verse, and he said it. Actually, there is another one, the very famous one. They said that the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said the most truthful poem or poetic verse is what a poet by the name Labid, he said. When he said, أَلَا كُلُّ شَيْءٍ مَا خَلَى اللَّهُ بَاطِلٍ, يعني anything other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is batil. He said, this is the most truthful one. In another hadith, actually, he says that if you don't find a word that you can understand, you look into the poetry of the Arab. That's where you can get the explanation. And most of the Mufassirin, by the way, either used to be poets themselves, or write a lot of poetry, or rely a lot of poetry to explain what the words in the Quran are. So this is basically this hadith that we have. Now, hadith number 242. حدثنا محمد بن بشار حدثنا عبد الرحمن بن مهدي حدثنا سفيان الثوري عن عبد الملك بن عمير حدثنا أبو سلمة عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال كان أصدق كلمة قالها الشاعر كلمة لبيد ألا كل شيء ما خلى الله باطل وكاد أمية بن أبي الصلت أن يسلم because of this.
The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, the most truthful statement by a poet is the statement of Labid. Lo, everything besides Allah is not. And Umayyah ibn Abi Salt nearly embraced Islam.
Because of the poets, because of the poems he used to make them. طبعاً, this poetry was known in Arabia. You know, people used to do a number of things. Number one, طبعا, they used to have something like an annual kind of what we call festivity for poems. And they used to choose the best poets and hang them on the Kaaba. This is why they call them al-mu'allaqat, and the hanged ones. And they are long poems, and they are very famous poets like this. Some of them, they say seven, some say 10, because the most famous are 7, but some people carry them to 10. They say there are 10 poets. So that used to be. And then every tribe, that's actually what their minister of information, because people used to convey things in poetry. And they say, if you want, and this is why the rulers and so on used really to be very careful in dealing with the poets. They don't try to offend them, because if one of them goes and says any poem, that might destroy the person, and then wipe the person's character altogether. This is why, like, poetry was very famous. Even there is a chapter in the Quran, for those of you who don't know, it's called the Shu'ara, the poets. Now, but what Allah says at the end of these poets, He says, Shu'ara, like these poets, يَتْبَعُمُ الْغَوُونَ, people who are, like, have whims and desires and so on, and they are not as truthful as they are, except very few, إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. The Prophet himself, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, had a poet, Hassan ibn Thabit. And Hassan used to make poems in defense of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then to attack the people who attack Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he had his poets, poems that actually said about Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, this is verse number 243. حدثنا ابن المثنى عن محمد بن جعفر حدثنا شعبة عن أسود بن قيس عن جبنة سفيان البجلي قال أصاب حجر إصبع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فدميت فقال هل أنت إلا صانع إلا أصبع دميت وفي سبيل الله ما لقيت. يا تفضل.
A rock fell on the blessed toe of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam and caused it to bleed, whereupon he said, you are not but a bloody toe having received your blow in the way of Allah.
Like this is a poetic verse. Actually, you don't understand it properly except in Arabic. In Arabic it makes like a very well-disciplined poem. Now this hadith number 244. Just to say that حدثنا ابن عمر حدثنا سفيان عن أسد بن قيس عن جندب عن عبد الله البجلي قال نحو like something. تفضل.
Who related a narration meaning similar to the aforementioned.
This hadith number 245. حدثنا محمد ابن بشار ابن يحيى ابن السعيد حدثنا سفيان الثوري حدثنا أبو إسحاق عن البراء ابن عازب قال له رجل أفررتم عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يا أبا عمارة؟ فقال لا والله ما ولي رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم، ولكن ولي سرعان الناس تلقتهم هوازن بالنبل، ورسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم على بقلته، وأبو سفيان بن حارث ابن عبد المطلب آخذ بخطامها، ورسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول أنا النبي لا كذب أنا ابن عبد المطلب.
A man asked Bara ibn Azib, did you flee from the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم during the Battle of Hunain? O Abu Umara, Bara replied, no, by Allah, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam did not turn away, but rather some of the people of haste turned away. They turned away when the tribe of Hawazin assailed them with their arrows. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam was on his mule, while Abu Sufyan ibn Harith, the son of Abdul Muttalib, was holding its reins. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam was saying, I am the Prophet, that is no lie, I am the son of Abdul Muttalib.
Hadith number 236. حدثنا إسحاق بن منصور حدثنا عبد الرزاق حدثنا جعفر بن سليمان حدثنا ثابت عن أنس أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم دخل مكة في عمرة القضاء وابن بيرواح يمشي بين يديه وهو يقول خلوا نبي الكفار عن سبيلي، اليوم نضربكم على تنزيلة ضربا يزيل الهام عن مقيلة وتسهل الخليل عن حديثه. فقال له عمر يا ابن أبي رواحة بين يدي رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وفي حرم الله تقول الشعر. فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم خلي عنه يا أبا عمر فلهي أيهم أسرع من فلهيه لهم أو فيهم أسرع من نض النبل.
The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam entered Mecca to perform Umrah, and Ibn Rawaha was walking in front of him saying in poetic meter, clear his path, O sons of an unbelieving folk. Today we will strike you upon his arrival with such a blow that will sever their heads from their necks and cause intimate friends to forget one another. Upon hearing this, Umar said to him, O Ibn Rawaha, how dare you recite poetry before the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam and while in the sacred precinct al-Haram? At that, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said to him, leave him be, Umar, for those words are swifter against them than a shower of arrows.
This is what I said about poetry. Actually, this is a good description of it, that even like these poetic words are more harmful to these people than showering them with arrows. Which means the Prophet ﷺ, in a way, acknowledged the power of poetry that the Arab basically used to defend themselves or to destroy people. If you want to destroy somebody, go to a poet who can say things that this person will be finished. Or you want to elevate somebody, then you can get another poet who can do that for them. And this is why this man was saying it in the Haram. And the Prophet ﷺ said, it's okay, you can do it even in the Haram. This hadith number 247. حدثنا ابن حجر عن حدثنا شريك عن سماك بن حرب عن جابر بن سمرة أو سمرة أو السمرة قال جالست النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أكثر من 100 مرة سبحان الله، وكان أصحابه يتناشدون الشعر ويتذاكرون أشياء من أمر الجاهلية وهو ساكت وربما تبسم معهم.
I sat with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam over 100 times. His companions would rehearse poetry in his presence, recall events that took place in the period of ignorance, and the whole time he would remain silent and perhaps smile with them.
This hadith number 248. حدثنا علي بن حجر حدثنا شريك عبد الملك بن عمير عن أبي سلمة عن أبي هريرة أن عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال أشعر كلمة تكلمت بها العرب كلمة لبيد ألا كل شيء ما خلى الله باطل.
The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "The finest statement said by a poet of the Arabs is the statement of Labid. Lo, everything besides Allah is not."
This hadith number, we said this before, like explained this hadith before. This hadith number 249. حدثنا ابن مني حدثنا مروان ابن معاوية عن عبد الله بن عبد الرحمن الطائفي عن عمرو بن الشريد عن ابنه قال كنت ردف النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فأنشدته 100 قافية من قول أمية ابن الصلت الثقفي كلما أنشده بيتا قال للنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم هي حتى أنشدته 100 بيتا فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إن كاد ليسلم.
I was once riding behind the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and I recited to him 100 couplets from the poetry of Umayyah ibn Abi Salt al-Thaqafi. Each time I recited a couplet, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would say to me, "Recite more," until I recited 100 couplets. Whereupon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "He nearly embraced Islam."
The reason why I said he nearly embraced Islam because this poem, يعني very close to people who believe. يعني he talked about the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He talked about the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He talked about the helplessness of human beings and so on. So the Prophet says this man has close to Islam for what he says. يعني. This hadith number 250. حدثنا إسماعيل بن موسى الفزاري عن ابن حجر والمعنى واحد. قال حدثنا عبد الرحمن ابن أبي الزناد عن هشام بن عروة عن ابنه عن عائشة رضي الله عنها قالت كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يضع لحسان بن ثابت منبرا في المسجد يقوم عليه قائما إن يفاخر به عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أو قال ينافح به عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ويقول رسول صلى الله عليه وسلم إن الله أوصاني بحسان إن الله تعالى يؤيد حسان بروح القدس ما ينافح أو يفاخر عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم.
The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam placed a pulpit in the mosque of Hassan ibn Thabit to stand upon and laud the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or he, the narrator said, to defend the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Verily, Allah Most Exalted aids Hassan with the sanctified spirit, Ar-Ruh al-Quddus." So long as he defends or so long as he lauds the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
طبعاً this means one, you can say poetry in the masjid. That's why most of the khutaba in the Arab world, like in Muslim countries who are Arabic speaking, almost sometimes half of their khutbah is poetry. And they use poetry for issues of wisdom, for supporting the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, and so on. The second, طبعاً, the Prophet went as far as putting a member for Hassan ibn Thabit. Hassan, as we said, used to be the defending voice for Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him the power of the world, like he was known. So the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام said, Hassan was supported by Ruh al-Quds Jibreel, and as if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is supporting him to give him that power of the word that come out of his mouth. So he is unique in that. This is hadith number 351. حدثنا إسماعيل بن موسى علي بن حجر قال حدثنا ابن أبي الزناد عن أبيه عن عروة عن عائشة رضي الله عنها عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم مثله.
On the authority of Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, who related a narration that is comparable in wording and meaning to the aforementioned.
Now this finishes the chapter. Now this is a new chapter, but it's a beautiful chapter. I say this is the most amazing chapter, and it's a long one. This chapter 938. باب ما جاء في كلام رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم في السمر.
What has been narrated concerning the nighttime conversations of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
طبعا nighttime conversations like when people used to sit and make like talk about stories and poetry and so on, like this is the conversation within his companions. Starting with hadith number 252, حدثنا الحسن بن صباح البزاز حدثنا أبو النضر حدثنا أبو عقيل الثقفي عن عبد الله بن عقيل عن مجاهد عن الشعبي عن مسروق عن عائشة قالت حدث رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ذات ليلة نساءه حديثا فقالت امرأة منهن كأن الحديث حديث خرافة فقال أتدرون ما خرافة خرافة أي خرافة خرافة يا خرافة إن خرافة كان رجلا من عذرة أسرته الجن في الجاهلية فمكث فيهم دهرا ثم ردوه إلى الإنس فكان يحدث الناس بما رأى فيهم من الأعاجيب فقال الناس حديث خرافة.
One night, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam related a story to his wives, and one of them said, "That seems like one of the stories of Khurafa." He said, "Do you know who Khurafa is? Khurafa was a man from the tribe of Udhra. In the period of ignorance, Jahiliyyah, he was kidnapped by some jinn and remained with them for a long time until finally the jinn returned him to human beings. He would relate to people the oddities he saw among the jinn. So the people began to say, such and such is a story of khurafa." Khurafa is another Arabic word for superstition.
طبعا دي حديث again relates to two things. One is that the jinn can have control over people by even kidnapping them, not only like what we call penetrating them, try to twist them, but talking to them. And this man, he says, claim that he has been kidnapped by a jinn. And also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran that even the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam ran through this experience of the jinn. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in I think Surah Al-Ahqaf says to the Prophet وَيَصْرَفْنَا إِلَيْكَ نَفَرًا مِنَ الْجِنِّ يَسْتَمِعُونَ الْقُرْآنِ فَلَمَّا حَضَرُوهُ قَالُوا أَنْصِطُوا فَلَمَّا قُضِيَ وَلَّوْا إِلَى قَوْمِهِمْ مُنذِرِينَ قَالُوا يَا قَوْمَنَا إِنَّا سَمِعْنَا كِتَابًا أُنْزِلَ مِنْ بَعْدِ مُوسَى يهدي إلى الرسل إلى طريق مستقيم يا قومنا أجيب داعي الله. It's a long story in the Quran, and there is a story behind it that the Prophet himself related it about them. They said one of the nights, I don't know if they're going to go through this somewhere here, but they said the Prophet Hassan used to go and like relieve himself. We said this before actually in the tafsir class. And then they said one night the Prophet alayhi salat, and at the time the Prophet used to have bodyguards, like people in the government used to go and guard him until he finishes and come back. And it used to be also his tradition that when he goes to relieve himself, he will take aside, make wudu, and then come and face people, or read the Quran, or make dua after that. So they said one night, and it's after Isha, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam went out, and people were waiting for him to come, and it didn't. He didn't. It took a long time, almost too close to Fajr. Even some of the Sahaba were saying, "Why don't you go and see the Prophet? That's what's happening. Something might have gone wrong." So the people said, "No, we know behind him there is nothing." And some of them said, "No, we can't just disturb him. We might take him." And they said that it's close, almost Fajr time. The Prophet showed up. So the Sahaba rushed to him and said, "Ya Rasulullah, we got so worried. We don't know what happened." So the Prophet smiled. He told them, "You don't know where I was." And then they asked him, and he told them this story about the jinn. This was about the jinn that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the Quran by saying, وَإِصْرَفْنَا إِلَكَ نَفَرًا مِنَ الْجِنِّ. He said when he was, after he finished, he would make some dua, read the Quran, he saw a jinn over him. And again, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the Prophet and the messengers will see the jinn in this dunya. We don't. Allah said this in the Quran, by the way, because in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we cannot see the jinn. بدي سياس الله سيد القرآن وط إنهم يرونكم من حيث لا ترونهم like they will see from where you can. In one of the hadiths the Prophet said this will reverse on the day of judgment, like on the Akhirah Muslims will see the jinn but the jinn will not see them. And there are very few instances where Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم actually described how they look. طبعا one incident, this one that we are talking about in Surah Al-Aqaf, when he was late and then they asked him, he said, after I finished, all of a sudden I saw the jinn standing over me. And he was so excited. He said to him, who are you? So he told him, I'm Muhammad. He said, are you the prophet? He said, yes. He said, no, we were expecting you to come. As a matter of fact, they said that we had, they were, because they said that even we knew that there was a book that was revealed before Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, like this book was the book of Musa and Isa and so on, which means they knew Isa, they knew Musa. This jinn, because the jinn are dressed like Muslims, like any Muslims. Allah said in the Quran, مَا خَلَقْتُ الْإِنسَ وَالْجِنَّ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ أَكْسُوِ اللَّهِ لِيَعْبُدُونَ يَا مَعَشَرَ الْجِنِّ وَالْإِنسَ. And all the time Allah addresses both of them. So the Prophet said, after I told him, he said to me, why don't you come and read this and tell people about this deen, and I will take you to my valley. So the Prophet said, I accompanied them. There is a place known now as Wadi Abqar. They call this was the place where the Prophet والسلام, actually went to see them. And the Prophet stayed all night with them. He saw their children, saw their wives. He saw what they do, what can eat, what they write, and so on. And then he started telling the Sahaba about this. So in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala confirmed this by saying, وَإِصَّرَفْنَا إِلَيْكَ. And when we sent you, نَفَرًا مِنَ الْجِنِّ يَسْتَمِعُونَ الْقُرْآنَ. And actually said, when they, فَلَمَّا حَضَرُوهُ, when they attended, قَالُوا أَنصِتُوا. He said, wait a minute, listen, listen. إِنَّا سَمِعْنَا كِتَابًا أُنزِلَ مِنْ بَعْدِ مُوسَى. That they said, we had a book, and you know, عَلَيْكُمْ السَّلَامِ. Of a book that was revealed after Musa, عليه السلام. And they narrated all the things that actually people knew about them. So this is what Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, inshallah. So here, he said that Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, that about this hadith that he told them, and he said this man was basically held by the jinn, and that when they relieved him, he came and started talking about what has happened. طيب, you read the part? طيب. Now, this is a famous hadith, but it's a long hadith, but this is called Hadith Zarra. Zarra means like a nickname for like the mother of Zarra. حدثنا علي بن حجر أخبرنا عيسى بن يونس عن هشام بن عروة عن أخيه عن عبد الله بن عروة عن عروة عن عائشة قالت جلست 11 امرأة فتعاهدنا وتعاقدنا أن لا يكتمن من أخبار أزواجهن شيئا. I think this one will read it part by part. It will be easier for them to understand. Sure. Yeah. You take this side and then we go. Go ahead. The hadith number 253.
Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha said, 11 women sat together and made a pact, an agreement that they would not conceal anything about their husbands.
طيب. فقالت الأولى, the first one said, زوجي لحم جمل قث على رأس جبل وعر لا سهل يرتق فيرتقى ولا سمين فينتقل.
The first one said, my husband is like the meat of an emaciated camel atop an insurmountable mountain. It, the mountain, is neither easy to climb, nor is the camel meaty enough to be moved.
طيب. قالت الثانية, زوجي لا أثير لا أثير خبره أو لا أنثر خبره, إني أخاف أن لا أذره, إني أذكر عجره وبجره.
The second one said, I will not reveal anything about my husband, for I fear I will not leave him. If I mention him, I will mention his flaws, both the open and the hidden.
Now, قالت الثالثة, the third one said, زوجي العشنق إن أنطغ أطلق وإن أسكت أعلق. قالت, طيب, this is the third, yeah, go ahead.
The third one said, my husband is lanky and ill-mannered. If I speak, I will be divorced. And if I am silent, he will leave me hanging.
قالت الرابعة زج لك لتهامة لا حر ولا قر ولا مخافة ولا سامة.
The fourth one said, my husband is like a knight in Tihama, neither hot nor cold, nor fearsome nor dull.
قالت الخامسة زوجي إن دخل فهد وإن خرج أسد ولا يسأل عما عهد.
The fifth one said, when my husband enters the house, he is like a leopard. And when he goes out, he is like a lion. And he does not ask about what he entrusted me with.
قالت السادسة زوجي إن أكل لف وإن شرب استف وإن اضجع التف ولا يولج الكف ليعلم البث.
The sixth one said, when my husband eats, he gobbles it all up. And when he drinks, he gulps it all down. When he lies down, he wraps himself up and he does not extend his hand to uncover any grief.
قالت السابعة زوجي عيا عيا أو عيا عيا طباقة كل داء له داء شجك أو فلك أو جمع كلن كلا لا كلن نكا. قالت نعم this is the seven. Okay, go ahead.
The seventh one said, my husband is completely useless, or she said, he is wicked and dim-witted. Every illness is his. If he strikes you, he will either wound your head or break your bones or both.
قالت الثامنة زوجي المس مس أرنب والريح ريح زرنب.
The eighth one said, my husband has the touch of a rabbit and the fragrance of perfume.
طيب قالت التاسعة زوجي رفيع العماد طويل النجاد عظيم الرماد قريب البيت من الناد.
The ninth one said, my husband is of noble stature. His scabbard is long, his ash heap is large, and his home is near the gathering place.
قالت العاشرة زوجي مالك وما مالك مالك خير من ذلك له إبل كثيرات المبارك قليلات المسارح إذا سمعنا صوت المزهر أيقن أنهن هوالك.
The tenth one said, my husband is Malik, and how great is Malik? Malik is better than that. He has camels housed in several pens, and they are seldom roaming. When they hear the sound of the lute, they know they are about to be slaughtered.
قالت الحادي عشرة زوجي أبو زرع. Actually, the hadith called Abu Zarra. This is the key story. All these women were talking about their husband. Like women sitting in a group and they're talking about women. This is the woman is the one who talked about this actual hadith Abu Zarr. قالت وما أبو زرع أناس من حلي أناس من حلي أذني وملأ من شحم عضدي وبجحني فبجحت إلى نفسي وجدني في أهل غنيمة يشق فجعلني في أهل صهيل وأطيت ودائس وأمت ومنتق فعنده قول لا فلا أقبح وأرقد فأضطجع وأشرب فأقمع أم أبي زرع فما أبو زرع عكومها رداح وبيتها فساح ابن أبي زرع فما ابن أبي زرع مضجعه كمثل الشطبة وتشعبه ذراع الجفرة. I don't even know how to read these things here. بنت أبي زرع فما بنت أبي زرع طوع أبيها وطوع أمها وملء كسائها وغيظ جارتها جارية أبي زرع وما جارية أبي زرع لا تنبت حديثا تثبيتا ولا تنفث ميرابها تنفيثا ولا تملأ بيتا تعشيشا. قالت خرج أبو زرع والأوطاب تمخض فلقي امرأة معها ولدان لها كالفهدين يلعبان من تحت خصرها برماد لمائتين فطلقني ونكحها فنكحت بعده رجلا سربا سريا ركب شريا وأخذ خطبا وأزاح على نعمة ثرية وأعطاني من كل رائحة زوجا أو كل نعم زائحة زوجا وقال كل أم زرع كلي أم زرع وميري أهلك أهلك فلو جمعت كل شيء أعطانيه ما بلغ أصغر أبيه أبي زرع. قالت عائشة رضي الله عنها فقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم كنت لك كأبي زرع.
The 11th one said, my husband was Abu Zar. How great was Abu Zar? He made my ears dangle with jewelry and made my arms plump. He delighted me until I delighted myself. He found me in a family of few sheep living in hardship, and he brought me to a family in which were herds and neighs of horses and cries of camels and the sounds of threshing and cleaning grains. Then in the presence I could speak and would not be rebuked, and I could sleep through the morning and drink till I was quenched. And the mother of Abu Zar, how great was the mother of Abu Zar? Her food containers were large, heavy, and plentiful, and her home was spacious. And the son of Abu Zar, how great was the son of Abu Zar? His bed was like a slice of palm leaf, and a single foreleg of a lean lamb was enough to sate him. And the daughter of Abu Zar, how great the daughter of Abu Zar. To her father she was extremely obedient, and to her mother she was extremely obedient. She filled out her garment and infuriated her co-wife. And the slave girl of Abu Zar, how great was the slave girl of Abu Zar? She did not divulge our conversations to others, nor did she purloin our food, nor did she fill our house with litter. She said, one day Abu Zar went out as the milkers were churning butter. While out he met a woman with two boys who were like leopards, and they were playing beneath her waist with pomegranates. He divorced me and married her. After him I married a nobleman with a swift and tireless steed, and he was skillful with the spear. He showered me with many valuables and gave me a pair of every kind of cattle. He said to me, eat, O Umm Zar, and take some food to your kin. If I had gathered everything that he gave to me, it would not amount to the smallest vessel of Abu Zar. Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha said, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to me, I am unto you as Abu Zar was unto Umm Zar.
Basically, if you notice, the 10 women were basically saying bad things about their husbands. And every one of them has some negative things to say about her husband, except Umm Zar'a. And Umm Zar'a actually went beyond her husband. She went to her relatives, his children, and almost praised everyone around him. And this is why the Prophet ﷺ actually sent a message for sisters. And if you try to please your husband really, don't like scorn his parents, don't say things negative about him, otherwise you get his animosity. And not only him, you can praise all people around him. Tanya, they deserve to be praised. You don't have to be a hypocrite. But that actually eases the relationship between them. And this is why at the end of it, the Prophet ﷺ says to her, I'm going to be like Abu Zar'a for you. You want to take Abu Zar'a and me like Abu Zar'a, which means you have to be in that relationship between the two of them. Now, this actually finishes this chapter. We're going to chapter 39. I think we go to 40. باب ما جاء في صفة نوم رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم.
What has been narrated concerning the description of the sleep of the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم.
أستاذ الحديث number 254 حدثنا محمد بن مثنى عبد الرحمن بن مهدي عبد الرحمن بن بادي أبناءنا إسرائيل عن أبي إسحاق عن عبد الله بن يزيد عن براء بن عازب أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان إذا أخذ مضجعه وضع كفه اليمنى تحت خده الأيمن وقال رب قني عذابك يوم تبعث عبادك.
When the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم would go to his bed, he would place his right hand under his right cheek and then say, O Allah, save me from your punishment on the day you resurrect your servants.
Hadith number 255 is a small addition to it. حدثنا محمد بن مثنى عبد الرحمن حدثنا بإسرائيل عبد الساق عن أبي عن عبد الله قال مثله وقال يوم تجمع عبادك. سندادشن ذاتي سد.
And the, on the authority of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he said that he said something similar to it, and he said, "On the day that you gather your servants."
يعني added to the one that he said before. طيب حديث number 256. حدثنا محمود بن غيلان عبد الرزاق حدثنا سفيان عن عبد الملك بن عمير عن ربيعة بن حراش عن حذيفة قال كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا آوى إلى فراشه قال اللهم باسمك أموت وأحيا وإذا استيقظ قال الحمد لله الذي أحيانا بعدما أماتنا وإليه النشور.
When the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم would go to his bed, he would say, O Allah, in your name I die and I live. And when he would wake up, he would say, All praise is due to Allah who has brought us to life after causing us to die. And unto him is the ultimate return.
This hadith number 257. حدثنا قتيبة بن سعيد حدثنا المفصل بن فضالة عن عقيل عن الزهري عن عروة عن عائشة قالت كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا آوى إلى فراشه كل ليلة جمع كفيه فنفث فيهما وقرأ فيهما قل هو الله أحد وقل أعوذ برب الفلق وقل أعوذ برب الناس ثم مسح ما استطاع من جسده يبدأ بهما رأسه ووجهه وما أقبل من جسده يصنع ذلك ثلاث مرات.
Every night when the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would go on to his bed, he would join his blessed hands together, blow lightly on them and recite into them, say he is Allah the One, say I seek refuge with the Lord of the Daybreak, and say I seek refuge with the Lord of Mankind. When he would wipe, then he would wipe his blessed hands over whatever part of his body he was able, starting with his blessed head and face, and then the front of his body. He would do this three times.
Now, by the way, this is a ruqya. The Prophet ﷺ, people are always asking us for ruqya. The best ruqya you do is this, that what Rasulullah ﷺ actually described. And what he said, there are other things to it, but he says that before you go to sleep, you stretch your hand, like if you are making dua, and then you read these three chapters, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ. And then you blow your hand, this is like blowing on a hot tea. You do this, and then he wipes his face, wipes his other bodies. In the ruqya, the Prophet والسلام, approved, he says that you read Surah Al-Fatiha and blow your hand, this way we do, and then read Ayat Al-Kursi, and the two quls, قُلْ أَعُوذُ رَبِّ الْفَلَقِ قُلْ أَعُوذُ رَبِّ الْفَلَقِ قُلْ أَعُوذُ رَبِّ النَّاسِ, and then you wipe yourself. In one, he said your forehead, like what it's called, where you put your sujood, and then you wipe the rest of your body. This is the best, by the way, ruqya you do for yourself. That's hadith number 258. حدثنا محمد بن بشار حدثنا عبد الرحمن بن مهدي حدثنا سفيان عن سلمة ابن قهيل عن قريب عن ابن عباس أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم نام حتى نفخ وكان إذا نام نفخ فأتاه بلال فأذنه بالصلاة فقام وصلى ثم توضأ وفي الحديث قصة.
The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam was sleeping such that a sound of nafakha, which can be somewhat translated to snoring, emitted from him, and when he would sleep, he would often breathe deeply, such that the sound of nafakh would emit from him. Bilal came to inform him that it was the time for the prayer, whereupon he stood up and offered prayer without performing ritual purification. There is a story behind this narration.
طيب. This is a continuation to explain the past action. That's hadith number 259. حدثنا إسحاق بن منصور عن عفان حدثنا عبد السلام عن ثابت عن أنس بن مالك قال أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم كان إذا آوى إلى فراشه قال الحمد لله الذي أطعمنا وسقانا وكفانا وآوانا فكم من منن لا كافية له ولا مؤدى.
When the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam would go to his bed, he would say, "All praise is due to Allah who has fed us and given us drink, and who has sufficed us and given us shelter. For how many are those with none to suffice them or return them?"
This hadith number 260. حدثنا الحسين بن محمد الحريري حدثنا سليمان بن حرب حدثنا حماد بن سلمة عن أبي حميد عن بكر بن الله المزني عن عبد الله بن رباح عن أبي قتادة أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان إذا عرس بليل اضطجع على شقه الأيمن، وإذا عرس قبيل الصبح نصب ذراعه وضع رأسه على كفه.
When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would take rest at the end of a day's journey, he would go to sleep whilst lying on his right side. And when he would take rest shortly before the dawn, he would put his blessed arm up, pitching his blessed elbow upon the ground and place his blessed head in the palm of his hand.
Time. This finishes this chapter. Then with chapter 40. ما جاء في عبادة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم.
What has been narrated concerning the worship of the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم.
This seems to be a long chapter, so we might not finish it today, but we are going to start it anyway, and then we continue, because it's a long chapter about the worship. حدثنا قتيبة بن سعيد وبشر بن معاذ قال حدثنا ابن عوانة عن زياد بن علاقة عن المقير بن شعبة رضي الله عنه صلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم حتى انتفخت قدماه، فقيل له: أتتكلف هذا وقد غفر الله لك ما تقدم من ذنبك وما تأخر؟ قال: أفلا أكون عبدا شكورا.
The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam prayed so long that his blessed feet swelled. He was asked, "You take it upon yourself to do even though Allah has forgiven by means of you the sins of those who came before and the sins of those who are to come." He replied, "Shall I not then be a grateful servant?"
SubhanAllah. This is a real story. So the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, Allah gave him this surety. There is chapter 48 in the Quran called Surah Al-Fath, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to the Prophet, إِنَّا فَتَحْنَا لَكَ فَتْحًا مُبِينًا لِيَغْفِرَ اللَّهُ لَكَ مَا تَقَدَّمْ مِنْ ذَنْبِكَ وَمَا تَأْخَرَ. That Allah says to him, "We gave you this victory and we have assured you that we have forgiven all your past sins and what you are coming." And the Prophet is completely forgiven by Allah. Despite this, he was praying until his feet were swollen. And he used to pray all night to do this on for him. So he was asked, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you this surety that you are not going, your past sins and your previous sins are forgiven. So the Prophet said really this word. He said, "Afala akunu abdan shakura? Shouldn't I be a grateful servant? If Allah gave me this privilege, doesn't it itself warrant that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala we worship him?" Yeah. This is why we don't worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only when we need him. It's always better to worship Allah at times you don't need Allah. And they say if you worship when you don't need him, he will respond to you when you need, when you need Allah, you find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ready for you. Now this hadith number 262. قال حدثنا أبو عمار حسين بن حريث أخبرنا الفضل بن موسى عن محمد بن عمرو عن أبي سلمة عن أبي هريرة قال كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يصلي حتى تورمت قدماه، قال فقيل له: أتفعل هذا وقد جاءك أن الله تعالى قد غفر لك ما تقدم من ذنبك وما تأخر؟ قال: أفلا أكون عبدا شكورا. سنظر نرسل الحديث أكشف.
On the authority of Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anhu, who reported, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam would pray so long that his blessed feet would become swollen. He said, "It was said to him, 'You do this even though it has been revealed to you that Allah has forgiven by means of you the sins of those who came before and the sins of those who are to come.'" He replied, "Shall I not then be a grateful servant?"
Actually, this is the third hadith he mentioned the same thing, and this hadith number 263. حدثنا عن عيسى بن عثمان بن عيسى بن عبد الرحمن الرملي حدثنا عمي يحيى ابن عيسى الزملي أو الزملي عن الأعمش عن أبي صالح عن أبي هريرة قال كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقوم يصلي حتى تنتفق قدمه فيقال له تفعل هذا وقد غفر الله لك ما تقدم من ذنبك وما تأخر قال أفلا أكون عبدا شكورا.
The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would pray so long that his blessed feet would become swollen. It was said to him, you do this even though Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has forgiven you by means of you, the sins of those who came before and the sins of those who are to come. He replied, shall I not then be a grateful servant?
This is more or less the same repetition of the hadith or some narration of it. This hadith number 264. حدثنا محمد بن بشار حدثنا محمد بن جعفر حدثنا شعبة عن أبي إسحاق عن الأسود بن مرثد قال سألت عائشة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أو سئلت عائشة رسول الله رضي الله عنها عن صلاة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بالليل فقالت كان ينام حتى أول الليل ثم يقوم فإذا كان من السحر أوتر ثم أتى فراشه فإن كان له حاجة بأهله ألم بأهله فإذا سمع الأذان وثب فإن كان جنبا أفاض عليه من الماء وإلا توضأ وخرج إلى الصلاة.
I asked Aisha رضي الله تعالى عنها about the night prayer of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. She said he would sleep in the first part of the night. Then he would rise for prayer. Shortly before the dawn, he would pray the witr prayer and then go back to his bed. If he wished, he would approach his wife. When he would hear the call to prayer, he would rise quickly. And if he needed to take a bath after intimate relations, he would pour water over his blessed body. Otherwise, he would perform ritual purification and leave for the prayer.
This hadith number 265 حدثنا قتيبة عن ابن سعيد عن مالك بن أنس حدثنا إسحاق بن موسى الأنصاري حدثنا معا عن مالك عن مخرم بن سليمان عن كريب عن ابن عباس أنه أخبره أنه بات عند ميمونة وهي خالته قالت فاضطجعت في عرض الوسادة واضطجع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم في طولها فنام رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم حتى انتصف الليل أو قبله بقليل أو بعده بقليل فاستيقظ رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فجعل يمسح النوم عن وجهه ويقرأ العشر الآيات الخواتيم من سورة آل عمران ثم قام إلى شن معلق فتوضأ منه فأحسن الوضوء ثم قام يصلي قال عبد الله بن عباس فقمت إلى جنبه فوضع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يده اليمنى على رأسي ثم أخذ بإذني من يدي اليمنى ففتلها فصلى ركعتين ثم ركعتين قال معا ست مرات ثم أوتر ثم اضطجع حتى جاء المؤذن فقام فصلى ركعتين خفيفتين ثم خرج فصلى الصبح.
Ibn Abbas رضي الله تعالى عنه spent a night in the home of his maternal aunt Maymuna. He said, I reclined on the width of a cushion as the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam reclined on its length. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam slept until half of the night had passed or a bit after and then he woke up and rubbed the effects of sleep from his blessed face and began to recite the last 10 verses of the chapter of Surah Al-Imran. After that, he went over to a watery skin that was hanging on the wall and performed his ritual purification and did so well, and then stood and offered prayer. Abdullah ibn Abbas said, I went and stood by his side. He placed his blessed right hand on my head and took hold of my right ear and twisted it. Then he offered 2 units of prayer and another 2 units of prayer and another 2 units of prayer and another 2 units of prayer. Ma'ana said 6 times. He offered the witr prayer after he laid down until the muadhin came to him, after which he stood again and offered two brief units of prayer and then left and offered the dawn prayer, Fajr.
By the way, this is called the description of the prayer of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, but this is the maximum, like of the sunnah. It just happened that one time he just only prayed the two rak'ah for witr, and then most of the time he used to do this. When he was traveling, he would just pray one rak'ah for witr. In some instant, he used to pray the three rak'ahs together without even sitting between the two of them. And that's all the witr. This is why I have variations of witr that we have seen with people. This hadith number 266. حدثنا أبو قريب محمد بن علاء حدثنا وكيع عن شعبة عن أبي جمرة عن ابن عباس قال كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يصلي من الليل 13 ركعة.
The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم would offer 13 units of prayer in the night.
نعم. This is why you see in Tarawih, some of the scholars say you don't pray more than 12 because the Prophet went to 13, which means you pray the 10 rak'ahs for Tarawih and then one for Shafi'i and one for that. This becomes 13. But based on this hadith, they say Tarawih should be 8 and then you pray 3, which is the Shafi'i and then the witr, and that closes these prayers. But طبعاً, there are other variations of the hadith. That's why people pray 20, 36, depending on which like fiqh or school of thought they follow. This hadith is number 267. حدثنا قتيبة عن حديث حدثنا ابن عوانة عن قتادة عن زرارة ابن أوفى عن سعد بن هماش عن هشام عن عائشة أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان إذا لم يصلي بالليل منعه من ذلك النوم أو غلبته عيناه صلى من النهار 12 ركعة.
When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would not pray in the night because of either sleep or if his blessed eyes overcame him, he would offer 12 units in the day.
طيب, that's hadith number 268. عن ابن العلاء حدثنا أبو سامع عن هشام يعني ابن حسان عن محمد ابن سيرين عن أبي هريرة عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال إذا قام أحدكم من الليل فيفتتح صلاته بركعتين خفيفتين.
The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "One of you, when one of you stands in the night to pray, let him begin his vigil with two brief units of prayer."
حديث نمبر 269. حدثنا قضيب بن سعيد عن مالك بن أنس حدثنا إسحاق بن موسى حدثنا معن حدثنا مالك عن عبد الله بن أبي بكر عن أبيه أن عبد الله بن قيس بن مخرمة أخبره عن زيد بن خالد الجهني أنه قال لأزمقنا صلاة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فتوسدت عتبته أو قسطاسه فصلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ركعتين خفيفتين ثم صلى ركعتين طويلتين ثم صلى ركعتين وهم دونتين قبلهما ثم صلى ركعتين وهما دون اللتين قبلهما ثم صلى ركعتين وهما دون اللتين قبلهما ثم صلى ركعتين وهما دون اللتين قبلهما ثم أوتر فذلك 13 ركعة.
I resolved to closely observe the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the prayer of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I laid down near the entrance of his house or his tent. He offered two brief units of prayer, followed by two long units that were long, long, long. Then he offered two units that were less in length than the units prior. Then he offered two units that were less in length than the units prior. Then he offered two units that were less in length than the prior. Then he offered two units that were less in length than the units prior. Then he offered the witr prayer, offering 13 units of prayer in total.
This hadith number 270. حدثنا إسحاق بن موسى حدثنا معن حدثنا مالك عن سعيد بن أبي سعيد المقتري عن أبي سلمة عن عبد الرحمن أنه أخبره أنه سأل عائشة رضي الله عنها كيف كانت صلاة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم في رمضان. قالت: ما كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يزيد في رمضان ولا في غيره على 11 ركعة، يصلي أربعا لا تسأل حسنهن وطولهن، ثم يصلي أربعا لا تسأل حسنهن وطولهن، ثم يصلي ثلاثا. فقالت عائشة رضي الله عنها: قلت يا رسول الله أتنام قبل أن توتر؟ قال: يا عائشة، إن عيني عيني تنامني ولا ينام قلبي.
Abu Salama ibn Abdul Rahman informed me that he asked Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, how was the prayer of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam during Ramadan? She replied, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not increase in the Ramadan nor any other month besides it beyond 11 units. He would offer 4 units and did not ask about their beauty and length. And he would offer 4 other units and did not ask about their beauty and length. Then he would offer 3 units. I asked him, O Messenger of Allah, do you sleep before you pray witr? He replied, O Aisha, my eyes sleep, but my heart does not sleep.
This hadith number 71. حدثنا إسحاق بن موسى حدثنا معن حدثنا مالك عن ابن أبي الشهاب عن عروة عن عائشة رضي الله عنها قالت أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم كان يصلي من الليل 11 ركعة يوتر منهما بواحدة، فإذا فرغ منها اضطجع على شقه الأيمن.
The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would offer 11 units of prayer during the night, one of which was witr. And after he was finished, he would lie down on his right side.
I think we should stop here, right? It's almost time for now. طيب إن شاء الله. Okay. جزاكم الله خير. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك. نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت. نستغفرك ونتوب إليك. وصلى اللهم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه وسلم. إن شاء الله we continue on the عبادة of رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, his worship, and we'll go from hadith number 272 next time, إن شاء الله. طيب. Just mark this down.